Welcome to the post show broadcasting live from Zeta TV in Los Angeles. This is where we elevate the creative cult. This is where creatives can be seen. So thanks for tuning in. Thanks for always watching us. I'm Poe. On Saturday, April 22nd from 11 p.m. to 2 a.m., Dark Matters number 10, Hollywood Secrets at the Pack Theater, 6470 Santa Monica Boulevard in Los Angeles. A panel of three real Hollywood insiders telling all about the seedy side of the industry. These are real folks who've worked with the biggest names in the business. They will appear masked with their voices altered so that they can truly speak freely. Trust me, this is real. Pack Theater's great. Gotta go. On top of that, L.A. legends Dennis Woodruff, a man who has directed thousands of his own movies, making a living selling them on the streets of Hollywood. Last but not least, Rumpology, inspired by Jackie Stallone, who they attempted to book, then realized she's now 95 years old. Sylvester's mother, I believe. Michael Bilo will have his rump read live on stage by real-life rumpologist Maggie Mystery. For more info, visit packtheater.com. Pack Theater is on Santa Monica, down from our old studio. On Friday, April 21st, 7:30 to 9 p.m. And Saturday and Sunday, April 23rd and 24th, 3 to 4:30 p.m. Four Larks, Homeric Hymns, Villa Theater Lab at the Getty Villa, 17985 Pacific Coast Highway in Los Angeles. The Homeric Hymns are a collection or of partial and complete songs from the 7th and 6th centuries B.C., written in the style of the Homeric epics. They reflect the earliest stories about the major Greek gods and were recited in public to honor them. Award-winning Four Larks returns to the Getty Villa with a chorus of actors, musicians, and dancers to create original compositions and ancient invocations from these ancient verses in an ecstatic revival spanning 2.5 millennia. Tickets are $7. For more info, visit tickets.getty.edu. Okay, so you ready? Today we're going to talk about the untold story that's now been told about the real Los Angeles metal and hard rock music scene. I have with me today the director, writer, producer of the Inside L.A. Metal movie documentary, Bob Nalbandian.
Hey, Poe. Good to be back here. I love the new studio.
You've been gone forever. Where have you been?
I've been over here, and this is the first time at the new Zeta studio, which I love, man. Digging the new vibe. Good to see my man Jake back. What's up there, Jake? There he is.
That's the Jake hand right there. The Jake hand.
So, no, it's great. It's good to be back, man. I've been out and about.
Yeah, what have you been doing?
You know, I've been...
You just got out?
I've just got out, man.
did your time?
I did my time, and I'm out. And I'm actually living up in Northern California, but I've been working on the new movies.
I know.
I wanted to be isolated. I'm in Sacramento.
Oh, Sacramento.
And because we were doing a Bay Area documentary. And so I left to do a bunch of interviews for the Inside Metal San Francisco Bay Area.
Oh, you traitor.
The Northern Bay. Yeah. Well, you know,
fucking
you did the LA, and of course, all those Bay Area people
do. Baby cried.
So, you know, you gotta be politically correct when it comes to these things.
Nowadays, it seems so. Or not.
So we're going to do the, and we actually all finished all the interviews for that, which came out great. And,
oh, you're
after
done with
the
them
interviews,
already.
It's like, you know, I was living out in Sacramento, staying there at my cousin had a place while I was, he had like a guest house at his place outside Sacramento, a big farm, 10 acres, beautiful.
Yeah.
And after I did all the interviews, I said, shit, man, why am I going back to L.A.? I'm going to stay out here. I like it out here.
Yeah.
So I ended up staying.
Till summertime, it gets 120 degrees.
Yeah, that's true, but I don't mind though. I don't mind.
I lived in Redding for many years,
oh, yeah.
And it's like the inferno.
Redding. I lived in Chico for a couple
so
of years.
You know exactly how it is. It's, you know, between here and there.
I like the NorCal. You know, you got to move around. That's a good thing about
being
single.
No, I think so too. I've been in Laguna now for the longest I've ever been anywhere.
Wow.
But who
South
wants to move
OC.
Away from Laguna?
I grew up in Huntington Beach, so.
Ah, so you know. You Absolutely. Look like a Huntington Beach dude.
Do I?
You do.
I look like a beacher? I was one of the few Huntington Beach guys that did not surf. All my friends, and we're talking back in the, you know,
everybody
70s,
surfs in
early
and rides 80s. A Harley.
Everyone used to surf.
It's just weird.
Yeah, I just never
the
got
Harley
into
surfers.
It. The
Harley surfers.
Yeah, that's
super
true.
Super trippy.
I remember them.
Okay, so I would like to check out the trailer, the first trailer. This is kind of encompassing all that you've done thus far.
Yeah, it's a little bit confusing because each movie has actually two parts. So it's a two-volume movie for each.
It took me like 3 days to
yeah
straighten all of that
out. A lot of people can't figure out, but the first one here's part one and part two. It's the first of the Inside Metal series, and it's called The Pioneers of L.A. Hard Rock and Metal. And this is basically, we wanted to do something when we, you know, I got the offer from Warren Croyle and Joe Floyd. You know, they were working on a documentary and they hired me on, and we talked and we said, you know, let's do something different. Let's take it from the beginning. No one really talked about the era, you know, the Van Halen era from the late 70s, because that was such a huge scene, the Starwood and all those great fantastic clubs, you know, before MTV hit, before the Motley's Rats and all that. There was a huge, the huge scene and the Rats in hit. LA. Yeah. So, I mean, we're talking, we want to go back to like 75 when Van Halen kind of started, and you know, they had bands like Yesterday and Today were a Bay Area band Y&T. That used to come over, Y&T, of course, they changed their name to, and Legs Diamond, and there were so many other bands. So we want to touch on
They don't talk about Tomorrow.
Yeah, so, you know,
Tomorrow didn't matter in that era.
Exactly. So that was the first, and then we'll stick with the first one there. You could go ahead.
Okay, well, let's just check out the official theatrical trailer, and you guys can check it out. Going on here.
Well, look at you getting Texas.
There was no hip hop. There were no boy bands. There was no punk. There was nothing. It was rock and roll.
You could sense when you went to Hollywood that it was, felt like there was more, girls. You know, the rainbow, you know, Richie Blackmore, Jimmy Page, Led Zeppelin.
Parties were like a phenomenon back then.
Things started happening so quickly, we were like, kind of like,
thousands of kids would show up.
But L.A. was doing it.
People underestimate the power of the 70s influence.
But that whole scene, you know, in L.A. was the scene.
The meddlers against the punkers.
He gave him some blow and a couple of Quaaludes and cocktails, and all of a sudden, you know, it was game on.
Helicopter shining the light down on everybody, man.
You give a young band like that, you know, a couple million dollars, they are going to get fucked up.
It seemed like we had the world by the balls. And we did. The LA scene was huge. God, it was wild.
Okay, tell us about this.
Okay, Madness. Well, that was actually the theatrical trailer. We did a edited trailer. We actually took that movie in the theaters when it first opened up. We did about 150 theaters nationwide, and which
Is
was kind
2014?
Of a trip.
2014?
God, 14? Yeah, 2014. 14, yeah, yeah. We did that before we put out on DVD, and it was an experience. It was a little bit premature. I wasn't really too happy with how rushed everything
it
was.
It needed more
the
promo,
theaters.
Probably.
Yeah. But it was a great experience. It was a great experience getting out to the theaters and doing that, and it got a real good buzz, and, you know, so that was really cool, and that kind of got the ball rolling. A lot of people saw that, you know, oh, wow, this is serious. This is actually, you know, going to come out.
It's a story that needed to be told.
Yeah, yeah.
And wasn't, weirdly.
Yeah, I mean, there were so many bands. Even, I mean, you saw in that trailer, Michael DeBar, who was in a band called Detective at the time, who were like the prodigy band of Led Zeppelin on the Swan Song label. And they were, you know, really big touted band in the mid-70s. And, of course, the band Angel, who were originally from Washington, D.C. And now it's great to see Frank Domino's out doing stuff and Punky Meadows. And they're kind of getting things back together. And, you know, so many of the artists had said that, you know, the documentary, you know, sparked a lot of interest back in them, which is great to hear, because these were the bands. I mean, I was a little bit too young to hit the Starwood those clubs, I remember that. I would follow that. I would listen to the old, you know, local radio shows on the original, like KNAC, when they had Homegrown and all these different shows, and listen to bands like Snow and A La Carte, who were a local, you know, Huntington Beach band where I grew up. They were like the kings of Orange County then. And it was cool. It was definitely a cool scene, and nobody really talks about, because many of these bands didn't put out albums. And it was, you know, like I said, prior to MTV and prior to the era when, you know, the labels started signing the LA bands. So
we're going to take a break and get back to it. Mm-hmm. So we'll be right back. Don't go away. Okay, so this has inspired a lot of musicians, for one thing, to get, you know, you put some heat under them, right?
Oh, has it? Also, thank you.
I think so. And that's another thing I want to talk about anyway, which you reminded me. It feels like and seems like, maybe just because I'm in the middle of it, but this particular scene is heating up. It's like revived.
I hope so.
I think a lot of it has to do with Ultimate Jam Night. And
yeah,
Chuck
absolutely.
Wright.
I mean, it's great. The Jam Nights, I think, has really brought in
a lot of people together.
Because the scene was really dying. I mean, you know,
it
I
was
don't
dead.
Have to tell you about all the clubs closing down.
Yeah.
You know, the key clubs no longer, House of Blues.
And
no longer.
Chuck Wright says, and DJs can't jam.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there's really nothing going on. I mean, they're open a few in downtown L.A., but that's a whole different thing. So
yeah.
It's good to see that, you know, Hollywood and the Strip, they're keeping alive with the jams. And, you know, anything to bring the people in and bring some actually true musicianship and that kind of old school rock and roll vibe that is missed so much here.
Well, the jams are ridiculous because there's so much talent in the room. Anybody, I don't care who you are, you're going to walk in there and your mind is going to be blown at the talent because there's talent.
Absolutely.
It's the real deal. You know, these are the best of the best.
Yeah, we got as you know, the Reunited Sound Barrier playing tomorrow night.
Yes.
And
very
we
exciting.
Got Bernie K going to be on the Inside Metal Show tomorrow. So
yeah, you know what? Is that in this next trailer that I'm going to show? The first one?
Bernie was in... It
Which
was
one?
In
or
yeah.
Well,
it's the second one of the Pioneers.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
The
3-minute trailer of the Pioneers. He'll be in that.
Okay. Well, let's check the first one out. The next one on the thing, Pioneers of L.A. trailer, and we'll see if he's there.
The LA hard rock scene at the end of the 1970s into the early 80s was a little bit strange because Van Halen had broken massive. But outside of them, no one else was really coming through, so you had a lot of cult bands.
Yeah, all right, Van Halen got signed. Okay, finally somebody got signed out of LA.
There was no hip-hop. There were no boy bands. There was no punk. There was nothing. It was rock and roll. That was the game.
Going into Hollywood at that time, it was just like another world.
Things started happening so quickly, we were like kind of like standing back watching as it was going on. You know, it was one of those crazy things.
A thousand
thousands of kids would show up to a backyard party, man.
And I see these two guys walk in. Well, it's Dave Roth and Eddie Van Halen. And Dave and Eddie come up, and Eddie's asking me, I didn't even know who they were at the time. And he's asking me about the guitar, man, how do you make that thing go down so low?
We had cleared all these tables out because they weren't ready for, you know.
The lights go down, the crowd starts to cheer, and Richie says, excuse me, and turns and looks right at the stage and watches Eddie Van Halen the whole set. Doesn't look away.
People who don't go back that far as the Star Wars goes, they won't realize what an absolutely wonderful place that was.
It just had this vibe, this energy was in this place, and you could really feel it.
They were up on stage and they were playing, and you know what they were doing? They were having a lot of fun.
There was another word for orgies then, it was called quaaludes.
He gave them some blow and a couple of quaaludes and cocktails, and all of a sudden, you know, it was game on in the bathroom with everybody.
The scene back then especially was like gunslingers.
He had the cheese grater on the back of his bass, so he'd rub his knuckles on the back of it, throw blood around, you know, it was a good show.
Punk and the biggest loogies on the guitar player, and he was just loving it. They're hanging all over his face.
And then Ringo Starr comes, and he sits down right next to me by John. He's like this, John Bonham's on top of me, and they're talking, and I'm just like some furniture.
It was just gonna be about steady pace, do what we're gonna do, period.
If you wanted to be a musician, you're playing rock and roll, and the competition was stiff. We got paid.
I remember going back, going like, I could do that.
So much of a bummer to see these great bands and nobody knew who they were or anything about them.
The LA scene was huge, and it was wild. I mean, it was just incredible.
So Jack is back.
Jack Russell.
Jack Russell, he just released his album.
He just put a new solo album.
And it's killer.
Still sounds great.
That's not solo.
Great singer. I'm sorry?
That's not. Did you say solo?
Isn't it a solo record? Well, no. Jack Russell's Great White. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but those are some killer musicians. Oh, yeah, Robbie Lochner.
Yeah. No, he's got Tony Montana back.
Tony Montana back, yeah.
No, he's got a great band.
Have you heard the album?
I have, yeah. It's good. It's good.
It is good.
A little bit different, but great. Very good. It's, you know, that's distinct Jack Russell voice.
Definitely, right?
I remember, Jack, we used to go to Dante Fox shows at the Woodstock all the time in Anaheim, and you know, they were like, you know, one of the top, you know, drawing Orange County bands, you know, along with A La Carte, and there were so many other cool bands, you know, Max Havoc, August Red Moon, all these old bands that we would just go to the Woodstock or Radio City or Concert Factory, Leather Wolf, and that was the time Metallica were just starting out. They did their first show, Slayer, were doing cover songs, and it was good times, man. I mean, the Orange County scene alone just had
yeah,
a great
that's
scene
true.
Of,
that's true.
Of bands where you didn't even need to go to LA, and then, of course, you had all the LA bands from Snow or Wasp or Rat coming out and playing the Woodstock and Radio City. And
well, and like Chris Hager was talking about, you know, there was the whole San Diego troupe.
Sure.
A lot of people from San Diego, which I didn't realize.
Rat and Warrior, of course, was Joe Floyd, our producer of the project. They all came up from San Diego right around the same time. And I think it's funny because I think Chris was in a band called Sarge.
At the
time, and they did a lot of shows with that, and they were a great band. Chris Hager, and then he was in one of the incarnations of Rat, then to Rough Cut. Watch the documentary, you'll see it was like musical chairs with all these.
It's like
bands.
Quiet Riot.
Yeah, bands.
You had to have seen that documentary, right?
Yeah, I saw that.
Oh my gosh, and I love the part where they have the, and then Chuck Wright, and then Chuck Wright's gone, and then Chuck Wright got fired. Chuck Wright, you know, quit.
The best part is when
Chuck
the guy's
back.
Getting his autograph, and he said, "No, I don't want you. You're not in the band." And he goes, "Well, I
no,
played
I'm
on
right
the
here.
Album. See, look at my name's on.
I know.
That's pretty funny. It's funny because I know you were talking about Chuck Wright earlier, and you asked why is he in the documentary?
I
would have hit him up because he was also in a band called Satyr.
He was in lots of bands.
I never
saw
S-A-T-Y-R, but they're a band that was never talked about, and everyone I remember back in the day." When, you know, bands like Snow, A La Carte, Smile, Satyr were one of those bands kind of bubbling up. And they were, I think, a little bit more progressive, like a Rush kind of band.
Yes.
And Pat Reagan was in that band, who also did a lot of stuff with Richie Blackmore. He produced a lot of the Blackmore's Night stuff. And he was a producer. He did some Quiet Riot and other stuff. But They were a band that a lot of people talked about. But, you know, there were so many people that we could have got. And, you know, when I kept getting more and more people, we had, like, way more interviews than, you know, Warren, the executive producer, was just pulling his hair out. Enough interviews,
dude.
Oh,
there were too many.
Get to the editing. So, you know, and we just got whoever.
Well, you just have to keep doing it then.
Well, you know, maybe. Maybe
we'll do. You
definitely
have to keep doing it. I think it's super interesting.
We couldn't fit it in one DVD. Yeah. Everyone's going, well, why'd you do two DVDs? Because we had so much material, and it's like.
Are they 90 minutes
they're,
each?
They're about 80 minutes each, and we were trying to cram everything into one 90-minute movie, and I'm just saying it's not working.
You would
working,
have lost
dude.
Too much. Not, yeah. There's no way.
And, you know, Warren just said, hey, dude, just do two volumes, and I'm like, okay,
you
cool.
need to do, that's, like, you know, another two.
So, yeah.
Well, and you have one coming out, right?
Yeah, well, the second movie is, which is out, you can see it streaming now. It's going to go on to Access TV as well. It's called The L.A. Metal Scene Explodes.
But that one's already been on Access, the first one.
The first
recently.
One was, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know what? They only played part one, but they're supposed to play part two. They kind of experimented with it, and apparently it did really, really well. They
I watched
really
it
happy.
On Access.
Well, there you go, see? And so
and
they
I'm
are going to play.
Absolutely.
So we appreciate that support there, folks.
I support any, the industry.
Any single person out there watching it, it definitely helps, and any response and reviews you could give online is always.
You know, I had Katie Darrell on the show from the tribute bands on Access. So I gave them a plug.
There you go. I haven't seen that show yet. I hear it's pretty cool.
At the Whiskey Every. It's not going on right now, is it?
No. Yeah, like a.
Oh,
Queen
did they just start again?
Different, I don't know.
Well, it's live at the Whiskey on Wednesdays. And I don't remember if it's on now or not. I know it was on. I think it's on now.
Right.
I think they started a new season. Should we take a break? We're going to take a break.
It's your show.
We'll be right back. Don't go away. I have in the studio with me a quickly rising young group of super talented musicians. A unique sound described as prog meets pop meets message. Please welcome Cassette Culture! Yay! And the crowd goes wild!
I think it's kind of coming back, and that also kind of ties in with the name. So it's kind of like a throwback culture we're living in right now.
I have a cassette player in my car. It is really, really trebly. Like, there's a lot of treble, and it's terrible, but it's kind of my favorite part about it.
Talk at the mic or I'm going to have to see. He's always the singer. Always the singer that can't use the mic right. It's your Mama, when I grow up, I want to be a musician. And Mama says, you got to choose. How serious are you guys? This is what you want to do?
I think it's the only way out for us.
The only way out!
Fitting into the model that we've grown up in, the societal model and all that, playing music is a
way to break out of it.
It's kind of a way to make something of ourselves in the world.
You appeal to a very broad listener base, which is a really good thing.
We tend to attract older men, which is a long-term goal for me, personally.
Seem fairly worldly and intelligent too, like, you know that there's
thank you.
No, you just blew it. Gabe, say bye.
But almost there. That's our motto.
Hey, welcome back to the Hollywood Post Show. So on Sunday, May 7th, from 4 to 6 p.m., Next Words MFA Creative Writing Showcase at Red Cat. That's Roy and Edna Disney Cal Arts Theater, 631 West 2nd Street in Los Angeles. Next Words is a reading series and publication featuring Cal Arts graduating creative writing MFAs. Taking place at venues across Los Angeles, bookstores, art spaces, and even a former city hall, it culminates in a final showcase at Red Cat. This year's anthology, A Running Moon, a selection of fiction, poetry, nonfiction, and hybrid genres, curated and edited by the students, will also be available for purchase. The showcase offers an opportunity to experience work that is uniquely Cal Arts. the result of a writing program housed within an art school. This event is free, open to the public, and followed by a reception. Reservations require due to limited seating. To RSVP, call Red Cat Box Office at 213-237-2800. Again, that's 213-237-2800. The event is hosted by the School of Critical Studies. So official. Critical.
School of Critical.
It's critical. On Saturday, April 22nd, Thursday, April 27th, and Saturday, May 13th, from 7:30 to 10:30 p.m., Tosca at the L.A. Opera, 135 North Grand Avenue, Los Angeles. How far would you go to save the one you love? A fiery prima donna is forced to play a role she never imagined when she becomes trapped between her allegiance to her rebel lover and a scheming, and the scheming of a treacherous police chief who will stop at nothing in his lust for her. Sounds super exciting. The explosive conflict between these three unforgettable characters comes to a hair-raising conclusion in one of opera's bloodiest and most intense dramas. The electrifying Sandra Radvanovsky returns to reprise her acclaimed portrayal as Tosca in a revival of the thrilling John Caird staging conducted by James Conlon. For tickets, visit laopera.org. I want to see that. I want to see all the blood. Don't you? Everybody wants to see that.
I do.
Right? Doesn't that sound amazing?
I love blood.
I like opera. I like blood bloody opera. Operas.
What better combination?
Blood and opera, huh? I know. Killing. Mm. Opera's brutal. Okay. So, that over with. Okay, so we're already halfway through the metal scene. So, next is the L.A. metal scene explodes.
Halfway through, yeah. That's the one that we were
talking
about.
That we were just talking about.
Yep. Part one and part two, we should be getting that up on, like I said, Access TV coming real soon. It's available on Amazon Prime.
You don't know when
iTunes
exactly
that.
That's coming
out? You know, they say it's going to be in the next schedule, in the next season. So they're telling us. I mean, apparently they paid for it. So, oh, thank you.
Here,
thank
hand
you.
Me that one.
Oh, wow. Isn't this great?
Isn't
champagne
great?
On the set. Love it. So it should be coming out, I guess, this coming season. So just take a look on the schedule. And you know, I don't. To be honest, I don't even have access. So I don't. I
you
have
don't
to.
Have access?
I don't have access to access. So
Oops.
I have to rely on other people to tell me when it's coming
well,
on.
Well, so. I saw part one, so on access.
All right.
So there you go. There you have it. Okay. Well, let's check it out. Let's check out the trailer for The Scene Explodes.
Yeah.
We had such a great metal scene in L.A. in the early 80s. It really was an amazing time to be here.
You go up to Sunset Boulevard and it was just packed. It was like Mardi Gras, heavy metal Mardi Gras.
Our dressing room at the Roxy after we played. I'm looking around and there's Vince Neil passed out in the corner in a pile of his own puke.
Yep, we're in Hollywood. We ain't in Alaska anymore.
The epicenter of metal is now happening in Los Angeles.
The UK press was particularly excited by what was going on in the LA and California, and in America in general by the early 80s, because new wave of British heavy metal had pretty much run out of steam.
At that time, there was so much good metal. You know, it was so good because it was so genuine.
I mean, you could feel it. It was electric. The air was filled with something that was going to happen.
At first, they were friendly and hanging out and all fun and games. Then it became competition.
The LA scene was so crowded with musicians, and everybody was getting to know each other. They all started sounding similar to each other because they were hanging out at each other's rehearsal sessions.
Things kind of got polarized and, you know, they're like, you're either part of this group or you're part of that group.
Everybody had their own take on this new form of music.
I don't know what I'm going to do. There's no way if that guy is the new guitar hero that any of us can keep up.
Keep fighting. It's just like getting a deal was just the beginning.
By the time of the early 80s, it was very, very hard to get shows if you were a heavy metal band or hard rock band.
We did some shows over that summer, opening for Armored Saint, and we felt that if we could kind of ride their coattails, maybe there would be hope.
We were in the dressing room next to them, and that's the, we heard them discussing their whole thing about they thought they were too heavy for L.A. and they need to move to San Francisco.
You know, we definitely had a bit of a kind of an identity issue at the time with just not belonging anywhere. You know, we were just outcasts.
We were all on the verge of being homeless.
The music is the music of the wild and the young.
So yeah, it's hard to imagine Metallica not fitting in or not being accepted. It's bizarre.
A lot of people, you know, they still say, well, Metallica, they're not an LA band, they're San Francisco. And they must have done about 30 to 40 shows probably in LA before they moved to San Francisco.
They didn't resonate with people at the time.
No, yes and no. They started to, after they came back to the Bay Area, I think, I mean, remember, you know, Metallica were doing something completely new, especially
completely
to LA. And, you know, there was, you know, in England and Europe, they were really into, you know, the new wave of British heavy metal and all that was exploding. Bands like, you know, Saxon, Iron Maiden, Motorhead and all that. So that was their influence. And they brought it over to L.A., which, you know, people didn't really kind of get
up
for.
Do you think it was because this is maybe a weird thing to say, but they're so much more sophisticated in their music.
Yeah.
Orchestral. And it's,
I would say, and to be honest,
complex.
When Metallica started out in L.A., they really weren't that great. We saw they were still a very new
band.
Well,
they made up for it.
You know, Dave Mustaine was on guitar, who was shredding. And, you know, it's funny because he did most of the talking because James didn't really, he was quite shy at the time. So Dave Mustaine would talk in between songs. And they had Ron McGovney, and they were still a little bit rough. They were mostly doing cover songs. They were mostly doing Diamond Head songs and, you know, Sweet Savage and Blitzkrieg, a few other songs. But it took them a while, but I remember after they went to San Francisco, they came back and did some shows. They opened for Y&T. They just started calling themselves Y&T at that point when they did the Earthshaker album. I think Black Tiger was just coming out. They played the Woodstock and Metallica opened that, and it was like night and day. It was like Metallica were just so pro and so killer. It's like, wow. And you could, that was when I could really see the
potential.
So
they progressed
there.
A lot.
They progressed a lot, and then they did a few more shows in L.A. And then they, you know, got Cliff in the band and moved out.
So,
to,
you know, I guess
Bay
it
Air.
Just wasn't, it's timing. It just wasn't their time, man.
Yeah. And we're going to be doing, featuring a lot of Metallica in the next two, with Lars is also going to be in the next one, Rise of LA Thrash Metal, which we'll get into, and the Bay Area one. But I want to make note about that trailer you just played. I was just laughing watching it because we did all the trailers for all three back in 2013. So we didn't finish the interviews for the Rise of LA Thrash Metal when we did this trailer. So we had so many others, like Stephen Piercy you know, the guys in Striper and Leatherwolf and, you know, so many other bands that aren't in the trailer, you know, Wasp, other stuff. But
they
wanted to rush a trailer because we wanted people to see that this was real because, you know, it had been so long since we did the interview. So once we got that out, we kind of got a second boost in interest I'm just kind of laughing watching the trailer now. It's like, you know, there were so many other artists in the movie that were trailer, but
well, it just makes people have to watch the movie now.
Exactly.
You gotta watch them.
Teaser.
It's history.
Yes.
LA history, and now you're working on San Francisco history.
Yeah,
that's gonna be killer.
Well, we're editing the Rise of LA Thrash Metal, and that's gonna have many of the same artists featured in the other ones, the thrash bands.
Now that's when they start getting mad at each other, right?
Well, no.
There was conflict in that.
Well, there was definitely, but this is going to be, I mean, we've got, you know, Metallica, Megadeth, Slayer, Anthrax, Frank Bello, you know, so we got the big four in there. And we, you know, they talk big about their four. Shows in LA when Anthrax first came out of the West Coast and that kind of thing. And of course, Megadeth, you know, were an LA band, Slayer, an LA band. So three out of the four, big four, were in LA. And then we have like Suicidal Tendencies, bands like Cryptic Slaughter, and just a lot of bands that really, you know, Abattoir, Agent Steel, you know, and a lot of other artists that talk about shows, even Stripers in this, because they talk about doing one of their early shows with Metallica. back when they were called Rock's Regime, and also doing shows with Anthrax on the Raven Anthrax tour and stuff. So we got, you know, a lot of bands that aren't particularly thrash in this. You know, Armored Saints got a lot of footage in this. So, but it just talks about how it evolved into an LA thrashing, and we really wanted to give credit to the LA thrash bands. Dark Angel, of course, are in it. Hyrax, of course, you know, DJ Will, a lot of people that were so important to the thrashing, not just in LA, but worldwide. And it really spawned from LA to the Bay Area.
And it's funny because you couldn't see any of this coming either.
No, nobody, it was very underground.
Nobody saw this coming.
None of these bands were, you know, they would play the Strip, the Roxy, the Troubadour, and then they would get banned.
Because it's a happening. It's something that happened.
Yeah. And you know, people were slam dancing and stage diving. Yeah. So they got banned. So they ended up playing shows in places like Watts and the Olympic Auditorium. And just, and, you know, and they were playing with punk bands. So, and East LA did a lot of great, you know, a thrash metal show. So, you know, a lot of these bands didn't really get the success they deserved and the attention they deserved because it was so overshadowed by the glam scene in LA. And so, because
they looked so good with their big hair. We got to take a break.
That was she that said that.
We got to take a break. We'll be right back. Don't go away. An immersive rock and roll show, Ultimate Jam Night, which everybody needs to go to every single Tuesday at the Whiskey A Go-Go. Chuck Wright! How did the Ultimate Jam Night come about? Was that your brainchild?
Yes, it was.
What were you thinking?
Yeah, exactly. I created a monster. About a social gathering, and that's what this is about. It's about rebuilding the community of musicians again, because, you know, all the clubs are closing, the DJs have taken over, you know, and DJs can't jam. I actually have a killer house band with Matt Starr.
Well, yeah, you do.
Well, Matt Starr from Mr. Big, who helps organize the thing, and Mitch Perry from Edgar Winter Group, and we just brought on Walter Eno from Survivor, and having Pauly Z singing. We put other players with us, but we also put combinations of players that have never played together before, like Nuno Betancourt from Extreme and Billy Sheehan from Mr. Big, have never played together before, and they're up there just shredding off of each other. We moved over to the Whiskey A Go-Go, legendary venue, the only one in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, where I cut my teeth in Hollywood myself, playing there. I was the guy putting up the posters for the shows on all the poles when you drive up Laurel Canyon when I was a kid. Yeah, I started here. The concept for this jam night was beyond just having the best musicians in LA play. I wanted to create a rock and roll circus. Organizing 40 to 70 musicians a week, and I'm losing my mind!
How rock star is that?
Yeah.
You seem like a natural at this.
Who, me? Me?
You seem like you know what you're talking about.
I'm just cheating off her notes here.
I know,
see?
My cheat
sheet. I see it highlighted.
I know. You didn't send me anything.
I know. That's she just stole from Facebook. I know she would. She was
not
a
just
stalker.
Facebook. Everything. A total stalker. Oh my gosh. Yeah, Susie Malone that was just on there for Ultimate Jam Night thing. Mm. I had her on my show and brought up that she was a Mouseketeer for 14 years.
Wow.
She's Britney Spears? How did you find that out? Go ahead, dig deep.
Well,
nobody
the Mouseketeer is usually the thing.
Now
that
she's a burlesque dancer. That
well, there you go. That's usually the first thing you do, and then you kind of work your way up. Was
yeah,
it like all the
up.
Christina Aguilera and Britney Spears?
Oh,
did they all
true.
Start out as
I don't
Mouseketeers?
Know if, yeah, I don't know if Susie would want to be in that, packed into that species.
I'm sure she wouldn't mind being packed into that
ooh.
Bank account category.
Yeah, maybe not. Susie's great. Susie Malone is one of my favorite humans. Cheers, Susie.
Cheers, Susie.
You have to drink after or it's bad luck. So that's why there had to be a delay, a voice. Okay, we're going to talk about what happened next, thrash metal. Mm. Right?
Yes, that is being edited as we speak. My man Curtis Don Vito is editing The Rise of L.A. Thrash Metal. And I also got to give props. I mentioned, you know, Joe Floyd, of course, from the band Warrior, who are featured in the L.A. Metal Scene Explodes, who were a great, great L.A. band, Fighting for the Earth, one of the greatest L.A. metal albums to come out of the 80s. And also my other co-producer, Carl Alvarez. I got to give him props. He helped me out immensely on this. And Carl's just a longtime metalhead. He's been involved in, you know, the scene just like me. But he's one of these masterminds that knows. His memory is like an elephant. We'll be interviewing someone, and someone will bring up something,
and they go, I don't know, it was
it was 84 or 82, and the guy, and Carl would say, no, it was June 3rd, 1983 exactly. At the Roxy, and then the guy would go, you're right, how the hell do you know that? You know, I mean, he's like one of these guys.
Chuck Wright does that, by the way.
Yeah.
Carl's the master of that.
So he has been so helpful, because that's my flaw as far as organizing and doing all that. So, you know, Carl and I had kind of this working method where, you know, we would, you know, because we had edited all these interviews, and then we'd have all these interviews, you would have to kind of puzzle everything together.
Exactly.
And so he was kind of my organizer, and he helped immensely on that. And then he does kind of the rough edit. We get it to the
editor. That's a lot of work and a lot of
fun. So it is. It's a lot. You know, we did probably way more interviews than we needed to. I mean, the L.A. Metal Scene Explodes, I think, had nearly 70 interviews.
Wow.
Which is quite a lot. So it's, you know, we put a lot of work into it. But we, you know, we want to get all aspects. So
did this last trailer, did that come later for episode 3?
Well, The Rise, we're going to play up next, right? The Rise of L.A. Thrash Metal. That's the movie coming out. And it's, okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Let's check that out. Let's check it out.
At our scene, beyond Slayer, Metallica, and Dark.
That is so thrash. That is so over the top. The most extreme music I've ever heard.
We were all hanging out together. We were all united around the belief in this music, and it brought us together.
San Francisco gets talked about all the time, but L.A. had a fierce metal scene.
But man, we had to fight the good fight against most of what L.A. stood for.
L.A. did not get the credit. It was stolen from San Francisco. They took all the credit.
All these bands started emerging who were following in the footsteps of the new wave of British heavy metal.
And it was just blood. It was just brutal blood, man. Just fights, and just there was no control. There was no control.
The danger was part of the excitement.
Came out the phones and set them on fire, tied them to a chair, beat them up. I watched them do stuff like that.
And I've got the biggest band in San Francisco opening for you. We're like, Y&T? He's like, no, Metallica. I'm like, who?
Good grief. You know, Metallica's much bigger than Diamond had ever were.
So we got a copy of No Life to Love, put it on, it was like...
Metallica was the first time I heard the punk element plus the new wave of British heavy metal put together. I'm like, this is it. I loved it.
Said, well, we're going to headline LA, that's our hometown, but we're going to headline, and Metallica will go on before us. Well, that was a big mistake, because then they came on and just destroyed us.
We were not ready for Metallica, and there's still like that thread. There's no way we're gonna blow away Metallica or anything, but I mean, you're gonna fucking try.
Come with me, open for Queensrÿche.
People really had no idea who we were. I mean, this is a big arena, and I remember looking at an audience of people having this look of terror.
And the whole place was, the ceiling was sweating.
Damn, that's Rockstar shit. Damn, that fucking roadies, you know?
You got all the metal guys on one side of the parking lot, and you got all the punkers on the other side, and the animosity's already started.
was just crazy. It was youth. You know, it was youth.
Okay, things switched up here a little bit, right?
Indeed, yes.
Indeed.
Well, you know, we wanted to do...
my favorite part.
Yeah,
so
John Gallagher from Raven.
So funny.
We got Brian Tatler from Diamond Head in this, and Wolf Hoffman and Peter Baltus from Accept, because we wanted to bring... they were really the influence for the thrash metal scene. You talk about Diamond Head, Raven, Accept, yeah. You know, bands from Europe that really brought... over that, and not just those bands, but several bands.
Exactly.
Of course, Venom and all the other bands that, you know, did the black metal and brought all that into it. But it really kind of started in England and came over. So I wanted to get that aspect as well. And, you know, Metallica was that their first tour was with opening for Raven here in the States. And that's really what broke them.
Yeah, but, yeah, it says, well, part of my notes here is San Francisco. It's talking about San Francisco thrash bands.
Well, that's...
But, truth be told.
Yeah, well...
LA's a birthplace of three of the big four.
That's true. That's true. If you talk about
Metallica, Megadeth.
And Slayer. And, of course, Anthrax from New York.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of people don't like to be called LA bands because it was so... like I said, overshadowed by the glam scene, so a lot of these bands were embarrassed about it. And
so
they
there
went
was
up
controversy
to the Bay Area.
In there.
Yeah, and they get into that a lot in this documentary, and also in the following one, the San Francisco Inside Metal San Francisco. We don't have the
one you're working
solidified
on.
Title. It's actually we did all the interviews for that, and again, we got about 50 interviews there. I mean, a lot of the LA bands talking about their experience going to San Francisco, because you know you talk about Slayer, Metallica. I mean, Metallica. That's where they really made it, was in going to San Francisco.
Exactly.
And Megadeth and all these Dark Angel and Hyrax and all these bands, their experience going out there, Armored Saint. And of course, we talked to all these bands like the San Francisco thrash bands, Testament, who were legacy at the time, Forbidden, Exodus, we get into Death Angel, all these bands. And we also get into the more mainstream bands that were, Vane, Davey Vane, who were a prominent band out there, Head On. I mean, a lot of Vicious Rumors, Damage. I mean, so many bands we spoke with there. So not just Anvil Chorus, Doug Piercy. So it really captures what the Bay Area was all about.
Yeah,
not
yeah.
just thrash, but Jet Boy. But kind of the combination of everything that was going on in the Bay Area and how it related, of course, to LA, and of course Y&T and so many of the bands that were featured in these
yesterday
movies.
And today, but not
there
tomorrow.
Okay, right.
So let's talk about what's happening tomorrow night.
Tomorrow
and
night,
and actually after this show, and tomorrow.
Yeah,
right?
Well, I'm doing my debut Inside Metal show. So if you're online, stay online
on
Zynna.tv
or
Zynna.com.
Or you
well. Take
it's
a lunch
Zynna
break.
Zynna.tv.
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 Go to stay here. Get
stay
some
here.
Lunch after the show.
Okay, and what's going to happen?
Back at
what's going to happen 3
p.m.
here?
We got Bernie K from Soundbearer. They're doing the big Soundbearer reunion, and of course,
you can pull that
said,
poster for tomorrow night for
there you
the
go.
Jam night.
There you go. The ultimate jam night, of course. Tom Morello producing the new Soundbearer record.
Metal has no color.
We are so excited about, because Soundbearer were one of those bands.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
They were the first all-black hard rock metal band that got signed to a major label. And they were one of the first, before Motley and all these other bands got signed. Well, not the first. I mean, of course, you had the earlier band, Van Halen and Legs Diamond and, Yesterday and Today that had deals out. But before the big LA metal scene explosion, Soundbearer really kicked that off. It was Soundbearer signed with MCA, and then you had Quiet Riot and Motley and Rat.
But they had a lot of
Madison,
hurdles.
Black
they had a
Blue.
Lot of hurdles they had to jump through.
Absolutely, and they were a
black
such a
and
great
metal
band.
Didn't go together then.
Yeah, it was kind of a new
like,
thing.
Who the hell is this?
And this was long before Living Color and so many bands.
Exactly.
And, but they were great. I caught a lot of their early shows. I mean, I saw them. In Orange County and L.A., I remember a show at Radio City. It was Motley Crue, Rat, and Soundbearer.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So they did shows with Metallica. They did shows with Steeler a lot, which was Ron Keel's band. So they were playing alongside all the LA metal bands, but they were a little bit before that era and continued on and you know, ended up splitting apart, and Bernie and the drummer, the late great Dave Brown on drums, were in a band. They were in a band called Total Eclipse with Victor Johnson, who is now in, he's been in Sammy Hager's band for like, what, 20 years.
Yeah.
And
who's on Access TV all the time.
Yeah, there you go.
Mr. And, Hager.
Yeah, that's right. Spacey had a couple side bands as well, too. He had a Spacey's actually in the thrash metal episode because he had a thrash band called Gangland with the bass player Stanley.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And so, yeah, so a lot of history there. Anyway.
Okay.
I blabber a lot, but, you know, basically a great band. Go see the show
tomorrow
night.
But you'll be back at 3 o'clock.
I will.
You'll be back at 3 o'clock.
With Bernie Kay. And I got to mention Stu Herrera from KLOS.
Stu,
one of the big program directors. He brought metal back to L.A., did the Horns Up show on KLOS. If you guys notice, the last few months, KLOS, well, probably the last year, KLOS has gotten much heavier. The guy I'm going to have on the Inside Metal show, Stu Herrera, is 100% responsible for that. So
100% responsible.
Check that out. And
okay, so tell us where we can find you, where we can find the Inside Metal documentaries. We're over time. And I want to put that video in the end as we, you can do that instead of the other for Ultimate Jam Night. So where can we find you and your stuff?
I'm on
besides
Facebook,
at 3 o'clock.
And
at Zena TV.
On Zena TV. Oh, Inside Metal on Zena TV. We're bringing it back, fellas. It will be
what about the girls?
Debut episode. What about the girls?
Fellas.
Oh,
I'm not a fella.
And girls and all. Ladies and gentlemen, we are bringing it back.
Gentlemen.
And you could contact me on what, Facebook?
And we'll see you at Ultimate Jam Night tomorrow night.
I will be there. Absolutely.
Okay. So anybody who's been on the show is going to be on the show. All of the archives of social media of the show, go to wetpuzzlepiece.com. You'll see it all. I probably won't have this archive on tonight, but I'll have it on tomorrow, and we're on iTunes too if you don't have to see us, if you just want to listen. We're going to leave you with a little promo for Ultimate Jam Night for tomorrow night, because metal has no color. So check that out, and we'll see you next week. Ciao.
Sound Barrier is a great heavy metal band that more people should know about. I remember being just shocked to see this all-black heavy metal band. And it looked to me like a black Judas Priest.
Right.